Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you and a great welcome to this month's lecture. I am delighted and honoured to know that the Institute of Seamanship were happy for us to host their annual lecture. And for this, my thanks go to their chairman and members, the chairman being John Johnson Allen. It is great to have the Institute of Seamanship letting us do this again this year. The pause before we come in, for those who may be wondering what's happened, is to allow all 119 of you so far to come into this lecture. And we have a little screen at the bottom here which shows that we're actually now up to 121. And it's always fun to see how many are coming on at the beginning of a lecture, but it takes time to let everyone in before I start rattling on about whatever I'm rattling on about. Anyway, a great welcome to you. Thank you all for coming back, for those who are returning. If I may, David, if you can move me on one screen, that will be great. Thank you very much indeed. The usual housekeeping notes. Please do ask questions. I think probably this topic is fascinating, and I think probably will reflect quite a lot of questions. The way to do that is at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a Q&A, a question and answer icon. If you click on that, you'll be able to type in your question, and our trust manager, Fiona Sparks, who is here, will be collecting those and will be reading those towards the end after the lecture. We do have our usual wash-up, as I call it, after the lecture. So if you want to stay on for a very informal chat and to hear more from David and to exchange notes with the others, do please stay on. And our IT guru, Matt Edgar, will bring you in. It may take a little while for you to be brought in, a matter of a minute or two, but be patient and you'll be brought in. We will start our questions at the end and probably carry on into that wash-up session for the questions as well. Also to say that Dr. David Parry, our speaker tonight, has very kindly agreed that we may record the lecture. And so we will be putting a link onto the website, the Wellington Trust website, which usually takes 2 or 3 days just to edit it, to make sure it's tidy. And also that everyone who has registered, everyone who's here, will be notified by way of an email, so you can go back over what I hope is going to be an extremely interesting lecture, all 129 of you at the moment. I will give the apologies for my co-trustee, Jenny Mosley, who's normally here. She was not able to be here this evening, and so I'm afraid you're getting rather more of me than perhaps you normally have. If I may move now to the next slide, David. Very great welcome to Dr. David Parry, who, as you will see from that CV there, has had an interesting career. After schooling at HMS Conway, rather than going into the merchant service, even though he was from a Liverpool merchant navy family, he joined the RN, small cheer from this corner. He became a specialist submariner, and specializing in navigation and submarines. And indeed, I met him once. We worked out for a very few days in a submarine, back in 1974. He took his submarine command exam, which is known, as you will hear by the end of the lecture, as the Perisher. He took his submarine command exam in 1978. He went on to submarine command and left the Navy. In retirement from the Navy, he exercised his hobbies in maritime history by first of all doing a master's degree at the University of Greenwich. And as the outcome of that, his specialist subject was the escape of merchant shipping from the Baltic in World War I. This thesis was published, I believe, by the Swedish National Maritime Museum, where it rests today. He then went on to do a PhD in the evolution of the Perisher, at King's College in London. And out of that has come his not so long ago published book, which is Perisher, 100 Years of the Submarine Command Course, which I'm sure David can tell you a little bit more about at the end of his lecture. With that, and with no more ado, if I may, David, I'll pass over to you, and thank you for coming.
They bear, in place of classic names, numbers and letters on their skin. They play their grisly blindfold games in little boxes made of tin. Sometimes they stalk the Zeppelin. Sometimes they find where mines are laid or where the Baltic ice is thin. That is the custom of the trade. The trade. When the author of that poem, Rudyard Kipling, was asked what he meant by the trade, he found it difficult to give a coherent answer. We know, of course, what he was talking about is what today we call the submarine service. Life in a submarine is a unique way of life. It is one where every member of that submarine ship's company is essential to and responsible for both the safety and the success of the submarine. And no more so, of course, than the captain, the commanding officer, or the CO, as he's called. And it doesn't really matter what submarine you're in or in what navy, the job is pretty much the same. As the head of the Dutch Submarine Service said, command of a submarine is unique in the best of times and straight out of this world in the worst of times. So let's put some flesh on the bones of that supposition. Submarines operate in the vastness of the oceans, where there is a proclivity for stealth. He who hears the other first tends to win the day. So not much happens in a submarine that's likely to breach that proclivity of stealth without the express permission of the captain. Not even putting out the rubbish. In fact, especially not putting out the rubbish. Captains of submarines have been likened to spiders in the web and hubs on the wheel. In contrast to the vast expansion of the ocean, are the confines of the submarine, where it's a cheek by jowl existence. There's no 10th floor office for the captain of a submarine. There's not even a bridge for him to go and find isolation. He's in amongst his people 24/7. So all his idiosyncrasies are exposed to everybody. And if he picks his nose or scratches his ass, everybody knows about it. Now, aeroplanes go up in the sky and they have to come down one way or the other. Tanks can stop, and as soldiers will, they'll all get out and have a brew of tea. Submarines go down, but they don't necessarily come up. And that's just one exigency that a submarine has to have a capability to counter. There are others, and here's a list of them. And these come from the best description of the uniqueness of submarine command that I've read. It's a book by Eric Thompson called On Her Majesty's Nuclear Service. And I've left many of them out, like smelly feet and suppressed homosexuality. But take fire. There is no evacuating the building when you have a fire in a submarine. You can't even go out into the fresh air to relieve the pressure on your lungs. Submarines are the last bastion of what is known as mission command. We used to call it independent ship. There is no internet underneath the water. So a submarine captain can't phone his mum and ask for help, and he can't phone his boss and ask for instructions. Everybody below a submarine captain looks to him to make the decisions. Everybody above a submarine captain expects him to make the decisions. And he has to do that without succor, referral, or support. Now, some commands have greater responsibility and more intense responsibility for periods of time, but none have the continuation of the continuance of the environment in which a submarine operates, where a benign ship or a simple mistake can become an existential threat in a heartbeat. And other commands are ephemeral compared to a submarine. Submarine command is not just for hours, like in an aeroplane, or even for days. It's normally for weeks and often for months. So submarine command is isolated, it's challenging, and it's both physically and mentally demanding. Not surprised, therefore, that some submarine captains have to be seen to be fit to do their job. And this is where Perisher comes in. Now, you will recognise that Perisher is probably a nickname or a moniker. And the original name for the course was called Periscope Course at the Periscope School. Between the wars, it then became Commanding Officers Qualifying Course. And then in the 1990s, the Submarine Command Course. The word Perisher comes from that humble origin of Periscope Course. The man who runs the Periscope Course used to be called the Instructional Officer. Then he became the Commanding Officer of the COQC, and now he's the Commanding Officer of the SMCC. But he's normally referred to as Teacher. I'll be talking about Teacher quite a lot during the presentation. But first, a little bit of a health warning. There are many submariners, I appreciate, who'll be on this call, who probably know far more about what I'm talking about than I do. But there's lots of people who don't. So I ask for the submariners' forbearance while I just try and explain in some very simplistic terms what submarining is all about and how we go about our business. And if the submariners want to get difficult with me, I reserve the right for them to demand to give me the mathematical proof of the 1936 range, or as the Americans on the call will know, as 1935 Echelon range. Private joke, I do apologise, but I know it will keep the submariners quiet for the rest of the evening. Now, I'm going to tell the Perisher story in six parts. The first part is from the conception of the submarine service to the end of the First World War. We then have the interwar period, then the apogee of the Perisher during the Second World War, difficult post-war period, the height of the Cold War during the decades of the 70s and 80s, and then, of course, the post-Cold War. The numbers in red that you can see along the bottom there are the numbers of officers who qualified for submarine command in those periods. They total 1,165. And they average just over 11 and a half a year. That's just about one a month for 100 years. If you compare that to the hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people who worked in the Royal Navy over that 100 years, it is elitism by any yardstick. Okay, the first period then, the conception of the submarine service to the end of the First World War. And the first person I'm going to talk about here is a chap called Captain Reginald Bacon. Bacon's appointment as the first captain inspecting submarines was a clever appointment of a very clever man. Bacon gave a lot of thought as to what sort of officers he wanted to command his submarines. And what he decided was he wanted rashful officers. Now, it's a word of its time. It doesn't mean careless. He said they had to be careful, they had to be hard-headed, and they had to be technically competent. Bacon understood the axiomatic relationship between aging and risk adversity. And he wanted young men who would see an opportunity and seize it rather than thinking about it for too long. Bacon also inculcated into the submarine service some of the cultural ethos that is prevalent today. On top of that bill is safety. In fact, he had a plaque made that said, no one of us is infallible, even the youngest. And if any of his young captains exceeded the safety edict, he had to carry this plaque around with them all day as a penalty. He introduced an informality, especially for those days, mutual respect between all on board, the right type of leadership and technical knowledge. In a ship, you know your department. In a submarine, everybody knows every department. And they're nowhere better epitomized than this, quite a famous cartoon now, of a soldier visiting a submarine and not realizing what's going on. Now, I said that Bacon was a clever man, and so he was. And here's just two of his inventions. The submarine here, A1, that's one of his inventions. It's a grown-up Holland-class submarine, really, which was the first submarines, very first submarines. But he invented it. The other invention there is sticking up in the middle, and that's called a periscope. Now, before the Americans on the call jump down my throat and say Simon Lake invented the periscope, well, Simon Lake invented something called an omniscope, but Bacon can lay claim to the periscope. And indeed, Captain Cable, who was over in the UK when the Holland class were building, took Bacon's designs back to the United States. It was a chap called Howard Grubb who took Bacon's designs and turned the periscope into a hull-penetrating instrument. Bacon could not take out a patent because he was a serving officer. But A1 had an unfortunate life. In 1904, she was rammed by a ship called the Berwick Castle and sunk with all hands. Two things came out of that. The first one was a second hatch on the conning tower. And the other one was in the next batch of submarines they were building, which were C-class submarines shown here, they put in two periscopes. And the reason was that somebody could look around the horizon all the time. I have to say, on the next batch of submarines, they reverted to one periscope, but an extra long one, so the submarine was deeper at periscope depth. And that gave rise to something submariners will recognize as the periscope well. But this looking around the horizon became known as the all-round look. And this is my first divergence, so I asked the submariners to hold fire, because the all-round look is vitally important. The all-round look is when you put your periscope up and you look 360 degrees around the horizon. Now, Admiral Sandy Woodward, of Falklands fame, wrote in his book 100 Days about the Falklands that the all-round look is rather like being in Piccadilly Circus, lifting up a manhole cover, looking around, seeing where everybody's going, what they're doing, and then trying to remember it. Bit of an exaggeration, I suspect. But if you were in the submarine operating, say, in the English Channel in the summer, you would find fishing vessels all over the place. You'd find pleasure carts all over the place. You'd find merchant ships, big and small, ploughing their trade. There'd be ferries taking people on their holidays, and there'd be warships operating. I had the privilege to interview a chap called Johnny Murray Jones. Now, Johnny had taken his Perisher in 1946, just after the Second World War. And he told me the story that when he was doing an attack, a frigate rejoining the formation ran into his periscopes. Well, at the subsequent inquiry, the captain of the frigate was held to be responsible. So I wrote this up and I added a little rider at the end saying how times have changed. This heralded a telephone call from a very irate Johnny Murray Jones. He said, "What do you mean by this?" he said. So I explained how that the CO these days, the CO of the submarine, was responsible for doing the all-round look, and he was responsible for the submarine's safety. "Absolute rubbish," he said. I was doing an attack. I'm glad I'm not in the Navy today," and slammed the phone down on me. Well, the reality is, how many submarines found a watery grave because they didn't do an all-round look? Now, you may have done your all-round look when you were steering west, 270. And then you alter north, 000. Now you've got to remember what that merchant ship was doing and how it might embarrass you on this new course. And this is called situation awareness. And situation awareness is vital in the submarine CO. And teacher will look very carefully to see that his students have got good situation awareness. It's in other jobs as well, like pilots, of course. But only about 25% of the population are capable of having good situation awareness. I am told that if you have to...
...dash-ltd.co.uk, they say...
I'm sorry, Google quiet.
...is about getting in the mindset of...
Google quiet. Jesus Christ. Sorry about my Google girl. Now, I am told that that if you have to turn the map upside down, you probably have poor situational awareness. Though I have to tell you also that my wife disagrees with that supposition. The weapon of choice for submarines is, of course, the torpedo. And the young commanding officers had to be taught how to fire their torpedoes. And this was how they did it, so an example of how they did it in the simplicity. They'd take a flotilla of submarines to sea and line them up like this. Then they'd send a tender like this old sloop along in front of them. And the COs of the submarines were expected to find the right time and place to fire their torpedo so it passed under the ship there, thus indicating a hit. They had nothing else except a simple periscope and their eye. And this was called developing your periscope eye. And periscope eye became the sine qua non for submarine captains. If you had a good periscope eye, you were automatically a good submarine CO. Now, one man realized the paucity in this sort of training. And in 1913, he was in Gibraltar in command of a small flotilla of submarines there. He was short, rotund, had a round cherubic face. His name was George Bridges Lewis, and he was the youngest commander in the Navy, and he was universally disliked. But George was a clever chap, and he had the bright idea of building a simulator ashore to overcome some of this attack training. And he did in Gibraltar. And when he left, he took it with him. 2 years later, in 1915, he's in command of another flotilla during the First World War, and he sees that his COs are not getting the proper attack training. So he gets out his drawings, revamps them, and builds another attack teacher. It is seized upon. 16 are commissioned and sent to all the submarine flotillas, and one goes into HMS Dolphin at Fort Blockhouse, the altimeter of the submarine service. In 1917, the now inspecting, the Commodore inspecting submarine, Sydney Hall, has some problems. His first one is the expansion of the submarine service. Just look at these numbers. The submarine service is 1902 with 8 officers. By 1980, it's got 600. Now, the submarine service used to be a familial organization. Hall knew his officers and he knew who to appoint in command of which boat and when. But that had disappeared with the rise in numbers. Something else happened with that numbers as well, and that was a diminution of skills, especially technical skills and attacking skills. And one man who realized this was a chap called Arthur Waistel. Now, Arthur Waistel was a captain in command of a big flotilla in the North Sea, and he realized that his submarine COs were not cutting the mustard. They were not, and he put it down to a lack of sufficient attack training. And he wrote to Hall about it. His resolution to it was to bring in destroyer captains, who of course also fired torpedoes, give them a month's course in periscopes, and let the destroyer captains fire the torpedoes in the submarines, and let the first lieutenant, that's the second in command of the submarine, do all the submarine things. Well, you can imagine that went down like a lead balloon. But Hall, of course, had a trick up his sleeve, because he had Lewis's attack teachers. So in August 1917, he wrote to the Admiralty and said, I would like to start a periscope school. And they said, 5 days later, they said, yep, go and do it. And so in September 1917, the periscope school was established in HMS Thames, and they were given 3 F-class submarines to play with. And I have to say, the Americans won these early courses. The first instructional officer, the first teacher, was a chap called Henry Gill, very accomplished submariner. He commanded 6 submarines. He'd set up the Greek submarine service. He commanded the destroyer, a depot ship, and the submarine flotilla. And he, by all accounts, he did an extremely good job, because he got the OBE at the end of the war, although he had to leave the Navy because his eyes failed him. But it wasn't run on a strict sort of basis like you might think a school was run. It was all a bit higgledy-piggledy. And here's an example. This chap is called Paul Edis. And in August 1915, Edis was the first lieutenant of the submarine E-13 when she ran aground on the Danish shore trying to break into the Baltic. Along with his captain, Geoffrey Layton, and the remaining members of his crew, 15 had been killed by the Germans illegally shooting at the submarine, he was interned by the Danes, but he escaped. And in October 1917, he found his way onto the periscope course. Now, remember, he hasn't been to sea for 2 years. After 5 days on the periscope course, he left to go in command of the submarine called the E-38. And then just 2 years later, he was in command of another submarine called the E-24, when she was rammed by the battleship Resolution and sunk with all hands. So maybe 5 days was not quite long enough to ensure that Edis was a safe commanding officer. 100 years later, it takes 5 months. The Perisher moved from Portsmouth up to Campbelltown in Scotland, where it operated for the rest of the war. And at the end of the war, they did a round robin to determine what makes a good submarine commanding officer. And this is what they came up with. You had to have a calm disposition. He had to be able to make quick, good decisions under pressure. He had to have good submarine knowledge. He had to have the right type of leadership. He had to have good situation awareness. Remember the all-round look. And they said he had to be good at games. Well, they had this thing that if you could shoot grouse or partridge, you make a good submarine captain. What about those rashful young men? Well, here they are. Naismith, VC, Boyle, VC, Holbrook, VC, Lawrence, DSO, Horton, DSO, Cromie, DSO. The ones on the left from the Dardanelles, the ones on the right from the Baltic. Although I have to say, I'm pleased to say that the Russians recognised the worth of the ones on the right and awarded them the Cross of St. George, which is the equivalent of the VC. Right, that's the end of the war, and we go into the interwar period. And it's pretty chaotic to begin with. The records show it's chaotic. And I'll give you an example of how chaotic it was. There's a story of Lieutenant Tom Parkinson, who did his Perisher, qualified for command just at the end of 1918, just after the end of the First World War. How he got through, I don't know, because Parkinson had a problem. Every time he tried to do an attack at sea, he got the wobbles. He got nervous, and his nerves failed him. So he was confined to the reserve fleet and to instructing in the submarine school, which he did very well. 100 years later, Admiral John Lang, who is one of only 3 people who have done the job of teacher twice, said that some officers know in their heart of hearts that they're not cut out for submarine command, but they have to go through the parish and the rigmarole and things because their careers depend upon it. Also, during the interwar periods, there were a number of redundancy programs, and the submarine service lost about half its lieutenants. That was important because these were the men who were going to be the, or they didn't know it at the time, but they were going to be the submarine captains in the Second World War. Not all got thrown out, though. There was one chap called Michael Rimmington, and he was a cadet at Dartmouth. And his father farmed in Africa, was a bit short of a bob or two. And when the Admiralty offered him £300 to take his son out of Dartmouth, he readily accepted it. But Michael Rimmington was living with his sister in England at the time, and his sister realised that Dartmouth was classified as a public school. And the Admiralty had a thing called the special public school entry. So she immediately put her brother up for the public school entry on the basis that he'd been to Dartmouth and back into the Navy he came. And just as well he did, because he turned out to be one of our finest submarine COs in the Second World War, in command throughout the war, having to be brought home from the Far East at the grand old age of 41, when you weren't supposed to be older than 35 in command of submarine. They were also affected by politics between the war. And I'm not going to all these conferences and treaties and things. The effect of them was, though, that Perisher students were taught only to attack, how to attack warships and not merchant ships. And this is despite what the German U-boat fleet had done to the British mercantile marine in the First World War. Excuse me. Now, at the end of the First World War, they had submarines with multi-torpedo tubes in the bow. So they can now fire what we call a salvo. And here's a salvo. This is called a hosepipe salvo because you fire one torpedo after the other with a time interval in between. And that time interval compensates for the errors in the trigonometrical problem that you have to solve to get the right firing solution. And that trigonometrical problem is based upon matching that target speed across there with your weapon speed towards the target and determining at what point you fire your torpedoes. And that angle is called the deflection angle. And this little square is called the torpedo track angle. And the closer that is to 90 degrees, the less the errors come into force. Now, those errors come from your estimations of a target's course, range and speed. So I'm going to talk about those for a little bit as well. Let's take course. You determine course, the best way to determine course is by angle on the bow. They used to call it inclination. Now, just so everybody knows what angle on the bow is, the angle on the bow is the number of degrees round up to 180 from the front of the ship, from the bow of the ship. Now, here you are on the right-hand side of the ship, it's the starboard side, and you're about 15 degrees round. So that's your angle on the bow is 15 starboard. Here you are on the port side, on the left-hand side of the ship, and you just follow the beam there, so it's about 70 degrees round. And here you are looking out from behind, so you're about 140 starboard. If you take a bearing of a ship and then take the reciprocal of that bearing and subtract a starboard angle on the bow, you'll get course. If you add a port angle on the bow, you'll get course. Now, here's something else you can do. If you can estimate the range of that ship, you can apply something called the clock face rule. I won't go into the mathematics of it, but this is how it works. If you take the range of the ship, and you take that angle on the bow and divide it by 60, and it gives you something called distance off course. That is how close that ship is going to pass to you. Here's an example. If that ship is at 6,000 yards, say, you now know it's 15 starboard. So 6,000 yards times 15 over 60 is 6,000 times a quarter, and a quarter of 6,000 is 1,500 yards. So that ship will pass 1,500 yards from you. So it's not surprising, therefore, that the more difficult you can make it for the captain of the submarine to determine that angle on the bow, it is to the betterment of the target and the detriment of the submarine. There were also clever chaps, those captains during the wars, and they did lots of inventions, slide rules especially. One slide rule especially was the combined slide rule, which lasted well after the end of the First World War. But now technology is starting to play, and a couple of interesting technological innovations were important. The first one is this, which is the Admiralty Research Laboratory table. That lasted until the 1980s. And here, in fact, you see it in a submarine of that period, a porpoise or Oberon class submarine of that period. It's a plotting table, navigation plotting table and local operations plotting table. They also brought in the first computer. Analog computer, of course, and this was called the submarine torpedo director. It was nicknamed the fruit machine because it looked like a fruit machine that they find down the pub. And this gave you that deflection angle, the angle where that you fired your torpedoes at. The most outlandish innovation of the period came from a chap called Guy Doyle Hughes. And he was worrying himself about this course stuff. And he reckoned that if you could measure the virtual length of a ship and then compare it to the true length of a ship, you could get the inclination or the angle on the bow. And to do that, he used a rangefinder. And he stuck a rangefinder on top of a periscope. Unfortunately, that rangefinder was 7 feet wide. So somebody said to Guy, Guy, don't you think somebody might actually see something 7 feet wide sticking above the surface of the sea? So it went nowhere. But the periscope builders, now Barr and Stroud, took that rangefinder, turned it through 90 degrees into a vertical position, put it on top of a periscope. And this became something called the study meter. And this is how a study meter works. You look at your target like this, and then you take an image of the target up to a known height on the ship, and it gives you minutes of arc. You then divide those minutes of arc into that height you looked at, times it by 1,000, and you get the range in thousands of yards. Why thousands of yards? Well, a nautical mile is 2,025 yards. We're doing government work here, so we'll call it 2,000 yards, and we call it a tactical mile. And submarines always work in thousands of yards. So there we've done course and we've done range. Now we've got to do speed. Now there's lots of visual indicators to a ship speed, but the best way of getting a ship speed is to count the revolutions of its propeller. And to do that, you need an ASTIC. Today we call them sonars. And by 1939, they had developed a very good ASTIC called 129. And it was in the front of the keel of the submarine. You can see it here. And from this, they could listen to ships' propellers. Now, if you listen to a fishing vessel, it's got a very small propeller, turns very quickly, and you're not going to count how many turns that goes around. But you know what it is because the noise it's making. A merchant ship has a big propeller, and it turns much more slowly. And you can easily count the revolutions. And if you know the ratio between the revolutions of the propeller and one knot, you can estimate that ship speed. It's a bit more difficult when you've got two propellers, but quite easy. And when you've got a battleship, say, with four propellers, well, again, you're into the noise area, the noise spectrum, you know exactly what it is. So there we go. Those are the things you need to solve your trigonometrical problem. Now, to get onto Perisher, you had to work your way up through all the jobs on board the submarine. Until you got to first attempt, and then you got your recommendation for Perisher, you went on Perisher, and then you go in command of a submarine. In 1920, they bought the Perisher back from Campbelltown down to Portland, and the Thames paid off, and the Perisher now ran from HMS Vulcan, and then she was relieved by HMS Maidstone. In 1924, they built a new attack teacher for the Perisher at Portland. But they missed a trick because at the same time, they were building simulators for destroyers in Portsmouth. And had they put the two together, they could probably got something quite substantial. But they're not surprising that they missed a trick when I can tell you that the Naval Staff Course in those days was still spending 3 days talking about the Battle of Jutland and battleships, of which they had a few now, and just 1 hour about submarines on the Naval Staff Course. In 1926, they moved the Perisher back to Portsmouth on HMS Electo. So as the war approached in 1939, Perisher had established itself as a command course, and you couldn't go in command of a submarine unless you had a bit past Perisher. There was one exception, which we'll come to. Also, to pass Perisher, you had to do an enormous amount of attacks to prove your worth. They also brought in something called the requalifying course. Now, in those days, if a submarine officer wanted to get promoted, he had to go back into what we call general service, into the surface Navy, and get a recommendation from probably a captain of a battleship, usually. And then when he came back into submarines, they gave him a quick retraining course, and this is called the refresher course. It was also during this period that the first of only two, maybe three, officers allowed to take Perisher twice failed the first time, and he was a chap called Barwood, and he was Australian. He'd failed his Perisher at the end of his sea weeks. The next course sea weeks were just starting. He moved across onto the next course, and he just needed a bit longer to get his periscope iron. That's all it was. There were some limitations before the war about the training. First one was the torpedoes. British torpedoes did not have gyros in them. So we had to point the submarine at the target and fire these hosepipe salvos. American torpedoes had gyros in them, so they could fire an angled torpedo. German torpedoes had gyros in them, so they could fire angled torpedoes. British ones did not. There were no night exercises with submarines until 1938. And until 1939, submarines were still obliged to show their navigation lights so they could be seen where they are. This, meanwhile, is while the Germans were practicing their U-boat tactics in the Atlantic. The last Perisher finished in July 1939. Next one was cancelled because of mobilisation. So now we move to the Second World War and the apogee of Perisher. And the first man I'm going to talk about here is John Robert Garstin Harvey, known to his mates as Ginger for probably obvious reasons. Now, Harvey was a submariner between the wars. In 1934, he came home from the elite China flotilla and should have gone on Perisher, but he didn't. He went in command of a minesweeper for a brief while, then he left the Navy, getting promoted to lieutenant commander while he was on the reserve list. In 1939, he's back in the Navy, and because he was a submariner, they send him on one of those requalifying courses. But he hasn't done the Perisher, remember. There's just three of them on the course. Unfortunately, they've got no submarines to go to see him because they're all being mobilised. Unfortunately, they've got no ships to fire at because they're all being mobilised. So they have to do their entire course in the attack teacher, which they do. At the end of it, Harvey is sent to a training submarine, H-class submarine in Portland, but there's a caveat beside his name saying he's not to go in operational areas. From there, he goes down to the Mediterranean, because don't forget, the Mediterranean, the Italians haven't entered the war yet, and he's put in command of a submarine called the Osiris. But then the Italians do enter the war, and old Ginger finds himself on a war patrol in the Osiris, and he comes across a small convoy of three Italian merchant ships, and he goes in to attack them, but he's not up to it. He's not a good attacker, and he fires his torpedoes, and he misses them, but just as he misses them, out from behind those merchant ships comes an Italian destroyer called the Palestro, straight into the path of the torpedoes, and she's sunk. Ginger finds his way back to his base in Alexandria, and before he comes in, the boat comes out and says, well done, they call him Gangster Harvey, but you can't come in until you're flying this flag. And the flag he had to fly was the Jolly Roger there. That was the first time the Jolly Roger was flown in the Second World War. Incidentally, the First World War Jolly Rogers were not black and white. They were, the first one was yellow and black, and the second one was white and black. Okay, Perisher between the wars. The first teacher, wartime teacher, was a chap called Steele, Hugh, but he's actually called Pat Steele. And one of the early things he did was to take the Perisher from Portsmouth down to Foy in Cornwall. There he had two of those submarines like Harvey had, Oberon-class submarines, totally inappropriate. They were 2.5 times the size of the submarines that the students were going to command, and they had an absolutely useless ASTIC. But he did have a very beautiful target to fire at called the Warrior, and she belonged to one of the Vanderbilt's family. Unfortunately, she was sunk just a couple of months later. The Perisher used to be 3 months long. And what they did was reduce it down to just 6 weeks by halving the number of attacks they had to do for a start. By doing this, they reckoned they could qualify about 46 COs a year. And that's what they thought they needed. They also changed the way you got on Perisher, and they set up a points system, a meritocratic point system. And you got points for what experience you had, what are points for what seniority you had as a lieutenant, points for your age. Reserve officers tended to be a bit older. They came from the Merchant Navy and they got an additional point for their age. And you got a point for what sort of recommendation you got. If you've got an urgent recommendation for Perisher, then you got an extra point. The effect of this meritocratic selection was profound. In 1941, the seniority for people going on Perisher had dropped from a peacetime 6 to 8 years as a lieutenant to 3 to 3.5 years. The age didn't drop too much, but by 1942, that seniority had dropped to 1.5 to 3 years, and the age had dropped to an average of 24.5. This allowed officers like Tony Troop to pass Perisher and become a submarine CO at the age of 21 years, 10 months, and 21 days, our youngest submarine CO ever. But he was a clever chap. He went on to be flag officer submarines. From Foy, Steele took the Perisher up to Rothsey, based on HMS Cyclops and the 3rd Submarine Flotilla, and set into play what became known to generations and generations of perishes thereafter, where the duty student, the duty captain, would take the submarine to sea, in this case round the top of the Isle of Bute, through the Isles of Bute, to Inchmarnock water, where they did practice their attacks. He had two of those Oberon class submarines to play with. He had a new target called the Cutty Sark, beautiful ship, belonged to the Duke of Westminster, built like a destroyer, could do 25 knots. She was replaced by an old Dutch destroyer called the Z5, who got renamed HMS Blade because she had a razor sharp bow. And they used these things for the escorts. These are motor anti-submarine boats. They carried 6 depth charges. Finally, they got a couple of modern submarines, S-class submarines, to play with. Periscopes had improved by now, and we had binocular periscopes. That eased the eye strain of looking through the periscope. They kept it secret how they achieved that until the 1950s. Periscopes now also had a sky search capability. Aeroplanes are a great threat to submarines. And it had a camera capability, which gave submarines a new capability of reconnaissance. It wasn't taught on Perisher, but they just expected to be able to do it. But they used it to great effect before the North African landings, the Sicily landings, and of course the Normandy landings. They gave them another ASTIC, Type 138, behind the conning tower so that they could hear from here behind them as well as in front of them with a 129, sorry. And in 1943, they built a new big attack teacher at Blythe, a big submarine base then, but this was a very different attack teacher. It was built by a theatre designer. Instead of using models to look at, they projected images of ships against the ship, against the screen. But this attack teacher also had something else. It was called an Ascania trainer. Now, Ascania was a Jewish-German company, but fortunately it had American outlet, and this is where we bought the trainer from. And the trainer would train officers how to trim the submarine. So the lovely irony is here, you've got a German trainer training British submariners to sink German ships. I think it's wonderful. They also built another attack teacher at a place called Rothsey, and that lasted until the 1970s. And 1943, the war in the Mediterranean was starting to wind down, and people were looking towards the Far East. So they thought maybe we ought to have set up a perisher organization in the Far East. And they chose Australia outside Sydney, a place called Watson Bay. It was going to be quite a substantial organization with 3 submarines, but it didn't pull off, although people were recruited into submarines from out there. Now, radar started to begin to introduce this period in 1941 as well. But it was not received very well by British submarine commanding officers, despite what the Americans had done with it. The Americans took to it very well and achieved marvelous things with it. British submariners didn't like it. Remember that proclivity for stealth. British submariners did not like anything that transmitted. Now, received wisdom is that the first radar-assisted collision was between 2 ships called the Stockholm and the Andrea Doria in the 1950s. I can categorically tell you that is not so. There was one in 1944 when a Canadian Volunteer Reserve officer called Keith Forbes was doing a radar-assisted attack against another beautiful old yacht called the Breeder. She belonged to the Duke of Bedford, and he got it wrong, and he ran into the Breeder, and he sank her. And Forbes failed his perisher. Steele was relieved by a perisher teacher called Teddy Woodward, and then along came another chap called Lennox Napier. I'll tell you why in a second. Because they've now decided that 6 weeks was too short a time for perisher, and they extended it. And the last week, they took the perishers up to Scarpa Flow, where they could attack capital ships escorted by fast destroyers and frigates and the like. Very popular it was too. They also realized that 46 COs was not enough and they needed far more. So what they did was start overlapping courses, running 2 courses in tandem. And what would happen, they'd have one course running up at Rothsey, another course running down at HMS Dolphin, Fort Blockhouse. And when the Rothsey guys moved across to Scarpa for their capital ships attacks, the Blockhouse guys would move up to Rothsey. And that way they managed to pass far more COs. They also opened up perisher to volunteer reserve officers. Reserve officers could always do perisher, and by this stage, about 20 of them are qualified. In 1943, the perisher list was 10 Royal Navy officers, 8 Royal Navy reserve officers, and 2 volunteer reserve officers. Not all volunteer reserve officers were volunteers for submarines. but many of them found their forte in submarines, and here's an example. The first two, Teddy Young and Freddie Sherwood. Teddy Young had designed the Penguin logo in 1934. Freddie Sherwood was the second officer to fail Perisher and take it twice. And what happened was he again had failed his sea weeks just as Teddy Young's Perisher was starting theirs. And he moved across onto Young's Perisher and did it again. Once again, he just had needed a bit longer to get his periscope iron. When they completed the Perisher, Sherwood should have gone back to Canada for leave, but he didn't. He forsake it to go in command of the P-556. 8 days before Young, who went in command of P-555. So Sherwood was the first volunteer reserve officer to command the submarine, and Young was the first Royal Navy volunteer reserve officer to command the submarine. Then we have the only New Zealander ever to command a submarine, and then we have Australians in command of British submarines. You now have this meritocratic selection for Perisher, so you didn't have to work your way up. You could be selected at any stage. So how well did they do? Well, the straight blue line, continuous blue line, is the number of submarines in commission. The tall blue bars are the number of officers who qualified for Perisher. They built a lot of submarines during the war, and they lost a lot of submarines, and they lost a lot of COs. But they managed to qualify 233 new commanding officers, with just 8 failures. Quite extraordinary. So we come to the end of the First World War and the start of the peace. And the man who was in command of the submarine service at that stage was a chap called George Creasy. He wasn't a submariner, but he knew technology. And he recognised the importance of what was known as the snorkel, which became, in British terminology, the snort. We didn't like the snort because we said it was a dangerous for the submarine when it was being depth charged. But nonetheless, Creasy ordered one of his submarines to be fitted it to experiment. Now, the received wisdom is that the Dutch invented the snorkel and the Germans found it when they overran Holland. Indeed, the Dutch did bring it across to Britain with their submarines, but we took it out because it was considered dangerous when the submarine was being depth charged. But the snorkel was actually invented a long time before that. It was actually invented in 1917 by a chap called Johnson Robb at Scott Shipbuilders. And here he patented it, and here it is. And there's the induction mast, and there's the exhaust mast. Nothing was done with it. Now, in 1947, everything changed because the submarine service was charged with the interdiction of Soviet submarines, and they were not ready for it. So things had to happen. And the first thing to happen was the research organizations reorganized, and they started to produce new sonars, especially for the being built Porpoise and Oberon class submarines, and good they were too. And then the people at Barents Stroud started developing new periscopes. Now, if you've got a snorkel, you're not on the surface, so you can't take sextant sun sights and star sights, so you have to do it through a periscope, and that's what this periscope closest to you has got. It's got a sextant inside it. They also bought in new, very powerful search periscopes, the one behind it, binocular, but they were so heavy they had to be turned by electric motor, and you sat on a seat while you did it. And that was called the Lane Roundabout, because Commander Lane was the liaison officer to Barents Stroud at the time. They also bought in new torpedo control systems. TCSS-2 was the first, went on to a family of TCSS-9, and the fruit machine was replaced by a new computer. And then from the Rothsay attack teacher, remember when they built that, came something called a time-bearing plot. And here it is. It's a big square Perspex screen behind which a chap sits and writes backwards, plotting bearings and writing things on the screen. The Americans had huge screens, took over a whole bulkhead of the submarine. In the front of the screen, you can see that this lieutenant here, he's measuring something called bearing rate. That is how many times a bearing moves in a minute, the target of what you're lifting at. So let's look at that again. Let's digress. So you've got two submarines in the water, both making a noise, and hopefully yours is the quieter one so you can hear the other one. And you have got to solve your same problem of target course and speed. Now you've got the added thing of depth, but we'll leave that for the moment. But you can't see the target, so you can't guess his course or get his range. All you can do is hear him, so all you can do is get the line of bearing. So to do this, this became the bearings only analysis. So how do you do that? Well, now hang on a sec, let's go to your garden on an idyllic summer's day. You look up and there's azure blue sky, and you see an aeroplane lazily tossing the sky. Well, he's got a low bearing rate, But you know he is going extremely fast. And if he was any closer, he'd zoom across, and that would be a high bearing rate. Your neighbour's a bit of a biggles, and he's got his own aeroplane. It flies no more faster than a car, and it flies over your house, and that's very close, and that's going slow. So that's got a slow bearing rate as well. So you can have something that is far and fast with the same bearing rate that is close and slow. And all you've got to solve that is your bearings. So what do? Well, you go to your time bearing plot. And what you do is you start plotting the bearings of what you're listening to like this over time, against time. And you'll get a movement like this. In this case, you've got a bearing moving right. If you alter your submarine, you can make that bearing move left like that. And then you'll get a left bearing movement. And then by some clever mathematics invented by a chap called Eklund in the United States, you can get the range at that point there. Now, another thing you can do is that you can plot bearings with regular time intervals. And if you then take a pair of dividers and prick them off for a relevant speed to that time interval, you can see if you can get a match across those bearing lines. And if you do, you might get an indication of speed and course. So simples as the meerkats say, but it's not. It's very difficult. Okay, you have to work your way again up through the various jobs in the ranks. The meritocratic selection has gone. And what's replaced it is just a form called an SGM 1503, Submarine General Memorandum, that stands for. And you have to be with a CO for 3 months before you can be given a recommendation for Perisher. And sadly, the reserve officers can no longer become submarine COs. The last depot ship to leave Rosslea was the Adamant in 1957, but the Perisher stayed there. And the submarines, the Perisher submarines, instead of going alongside the depot ship, now went to boys, and the students lived ashore in hotels. Very rough. In 1963, we have the first nuclear submarine in the Royal Navy, HMS Dreadnought, with her revolutionary sonar 2001. Not 201, which was the next consecutive number, but 2001 because it's such a revolutionary sonar. And people looked on that with jealousy for sure. The implications of the nuclear program on Perisher were extensive because these submarines now demanded two command qualified officers, one the captain and the other one the executive officer or the first lieutenant. Then when they decided to build four Polaris submarines, they needed to find another 16 command qualified officers. So they had to bring people out of shore jobs and people back from working who were in ships and bring them back into the submarine service. So they re-established the requalifying course. During the war, various officers from various nations had gone through Perisher. They didn't have to, but they volunteered to do so. By 1948, of course, we got NATO. And by mid-1960s, we're now running NATO Perisher courses. Now, teachers loved this because, especially when they had something called the Standing Naval Force Atlantic, which was a group of six or seven destroyers or frigates from different nations, all with different heights, different characteristics, different propulsion systems, different propellers, and just to make the life of the student that much more difficult. Perisher now extended itself. It's out to 11 weeks, and it's doing far more number of attacks. They also introduced something called the roundabout here. Now, the attacks were very much similar, the Periscope I attacks, but this roundabout was something different. Now they're putting the students in more risky navigational situations and seeing how they cope with that. A bit more of that in a minute. At this period, there was no prescription as how you did an attack. Consequently, it was known as the art of attacking. And this brought us on to the last of the art of attacking teachers, Sam Fry, and the first of a new way of training submarine COs, Sandy Woodward. They were very different characters. Sam Fry was intuitive and empirical and an ebullient sort of character. Woodward was complete opposite. He was a great thinker, very clever, mathematician, and very reserved in his personality. What Woodward did was to codify what the best of the art of the attackers were doing. And he did this through the application of mathematics, through periscope planning. When you're going to put your periscope up, why are you going to put your periscope up, how long are you going to have it up, what are you going to get from it, by putting the students under mental arithmetic pressure. Didn't have to do that, you could have done slide rules and that sort of thing. But remember those characteristics of a good submarine CO, quick thinking under pressure. He wanted to put his students under mental pressure to see how they reacted. But all the time, he maintained the perspective of what he was doing. He was not now really teaching periscope attack. He was teaching safety, how you could handle your ship, your submarine, in the proximity of numbers of ships. And what he wanted to do was to inculcate a competence, which would become an unconscious competence, which would become a sixth sense. Because sixth sense in a submarine CO is the key to safety. And I don't think there's a submarine CO in the world, in any Navy or any submarine, that's not woken up in the early hours of the morning and gone out into the control room before something untoward has about to happen. That's sixth sense. By now, we've got gyros and torpedoes, so now we can fire angled salvos like this. So let's take a look at what one of these attacks, these Woodward attacks, looks like. Well, first of all, the student will be given something called the go deep circle. It's not really a circle, is it? It's an egg. And it's based on the relative speeds of the submarine and the ship. So the submarine and the ship are coming towards each other. The relative speed is higher. Therefore, the go deep range is longer. If the ship is chasing the submarine, it's coming from behind. So the relative speed is lower. So let's just look at this one for an example, 12 to 1400. This is the one coming from ahead. Okay, that is based on the submarine achieving 7 knots as it goes deep underneath the ship that's coming towards it. And the ship's top speed, in this case, 28 knots. You add those two speeds together, you get 35 knots. That's the closing speed. That represents 3,500 yards in 3 minutes, or 1,166 yards in 1 minute. Well, it's government work again, so we'll call it 1,200 yards, or 100 yards in 5 seconds. So just remember that. Now, what teachers do is that they arrange for one of these escorts to come past very close to that go deep circle, not go into it, but very close past it. So the student's got to watch that ship very carefully to make sure that it doesn't enter its go deep circle. If a ship enters its go deep circle, the student has to take the submarine deep. If he doesn't, teacher will do it for him, and that's a big black mark. Alternatively, if you go deep early, that's a big black mark, because that indicates risk aversity, and risk aversity is not a good thing in a submarine captain. It also have what they call the charger, and that will be somebody who's coming straight at the submarine. And when he reached the limits of the go deep circle, down will go the submarine underneath the charger and try and get up the other side to attack the target. So what would happen is they'd work their way up with one ship, three ships, five ships. And by the end of the course, they'd be doing five ships. And what would happen, they'd have two escorts on the outer wings, as they call it, two escorts doing skirters, one coming as the charger. Rosie, there he is. And the target would be behind it. The first thing the student knows about this is it is an all-round look, and he sees this lot coming towards him. Right, now, on the student's left hip is a stopwatch, and that is for the right-hand skirter. On his right hip is a stopwatch, that is for the left-hand skirter. On his wrist is a stopwatch, that is for the all-round look. Round his neck is a stopwatch, and that is for the charger, or later on, the target. And he has to keep all these four stopwatches running, and he has to remember the time on all those four stopwatches, because if he runs out of time, teacher will take control and take the submarine deep. Right, so the first thing he does is he looks at the right outside wing escort, and he does a sum. He takes the height, and he takes the range, divides the minutes into the height, times it by 1,000, and he gets the range of that ship. He then does that clock face rule, works out the range times angle and bow, and gets the distance off track. If that distance off track is sufficiently outside his go deep range, go deep circle, he knows that all he has to do is to look at that ship and watch his angle on the bow is changing as he would expect during his all round looks. So he then goes across to the left outside wing escort, and he does those same sums. Now he comes back. And he starts his stopwatch because he's looking at the right wing skirter. And he does the first sum, and he gets the range. This time he takes from that range the go deep range, 1,200 yards. Right? That gives him the range of from where that ship is until it gets to the go deep circle. He then has to mentally turn that into speed. So 5 seconds, 100 yards, yes. And this becomes something called the look interval. That is the time that that ship could theoretically go from where it is now to get to the go deep circle. So he's got to look at that ship again beforehand to make sure it hasn't reached the go deep circle, because if he doesn't, teacher will take the submarine deep and he gets a back point. So he's done that on the right wing escort, and he started his stopwatch, and he starts his stopwatch on the left wing escort, and he does that same sum. And then he comes back to the charger, and he does that same sum again. So he's got those three stopwatches running on those three ships, and then he remembers he's got to do an all-round look, and he does an all-round look quickly, make sure everything's safe, and he can see the three ships in his all-round look, and then he returns. He returns to the right wing skirter escort. He does all those sums again, and he makes sure he's going to come outside his go deep circle. And he goes to his left wing escort, and he does all those sums again, and he makes sure it's going to be outside the go deep circle. And he looks at the charger, and he looks at the charger, and he sees that coming towards him. And he looks at the charger again, and he says, "Right, we've got to do something about this." So he says, standby queue routine." Now, queue is a tank at the front of the submarine that lets in about 4 tons of water very quickly and makes the submarine a negatively buoyant. So helps it pull it down to go under the target. So once he's done that and he's ready to go down, go deep, he takes another range of the charger. He sees that it's on the go deep circle. So he says, "Full ahead together, flood queue, 90 feet, midships, down all masts." At least that's what most people do. Unless you are a classicist, like a chap called Colin Stockman, who did this in Latin, taking the precaution to tell the ship's company what he was doing, but not teacher who's wetting himself on the after periscope. So let's have a look at this in reality. And here we see a chap called David Charlton, who went on to be teacher in 1984, doing it for real.
"Now, this escort mate, put me deep. Midships, slow together. Stand by Q, Q team. Reach me, target, up."
The imminent prospect of having to flood Q has made David Charlton forget the main point of the attack.
"How about firing at him, Captain?"
"That's 24 minutes. Down at 1,600 yards.
But Charlton is close to making his decision.
20 seconds. Raise me up. Well, range. That's 25 minutes. Full ahead together. Flood queue, keep 90 feet. Midships down on Mars. Target set up."
And there he goes. Now he's got to get underneath her, and here you'll hear the escort going over the top, get up the other side and attack the target. So he's got to get the target on his weapon system. And when the target is ready and it comes onto that deflection bearing, he will say, "Shoot." You hear this wonderful cry, "Set." That means the weapon system is following the target, and the first attempt will say, "Fire," and away the torpedo go. Before I leave Woodward, a couple of things about him. Woodward was prescient. He foresaw that the submarine CO is now receiving much more information, and he needed to leave his periscope and start managing the information coming into the submarine much better. He also thought that the perisher should be split into two, and these safety weeks where ships are charging around you should be done much earlier in an officer's career. So if he can handle that, he can carry on to be a CO. If he can't, he can go back into the mainstream Navy and get another career there. But before anybody went on to command, they would have to do a tactical course before they actually appointed the command. That was in 1968. So now we go to the two decades of the height of the Cold War, 1970s, 1980s, a war at sea with no battles, no monuments, only casualties. Captain of the Red October. Okay, at the beginning of this period, the Royal Navy had 42 diesel submarines. By the end of it, had 16. At the beginning, we had four SSNs, that's nuclear hunter killer submarines, and by the end, we had 16. Throughout, we had the four Polaris type submarines. But we had some good innovations. We had a replacement for that 2001 sonar, even better one in 2020. We had better weapons. We now had Mark 24 target fish, and we had missiles and sub-harpoon. We had new command team trainers again. And now the command system, those plots you looked at and drawing of bearings and things, now gone away. That's all now computerized on command systems. In 1972, Terry Wood was a teacher, and he was hauled in and said he's got to reduce the number of frigates and times, the number of frigates they're using for perisher because the Navy's shrinking. So what he did was he reverted to what they did during the war, and he set up two perishers. One would do the attack teacher up north, and one would do the attack teacher down south. And when it came to the sea weeks and the sea attacks, he would put them in adjacent areas like this and run the frigates up between the two of them. And that way they got twice the worth for the money's worth, or twice the profit for the money's worth. Perisher now is starting to extend itself. It's out to 20 weeks. And look what's happening. The safety part, those ships going past you, is now 4 weeks, and the tactical part is 6.5 weeks. What you're seeing now is Perisher changing its style. Perisher is now becoming much more intuitive, much more investigative into how a submarine, a potential submarine CO, reacts when he has to deal with decision-rich, risk-complex, pressurized situations. This is the time he now has to show whether he can wear the command, the mantle of command, and be seen to be so. And so now Perisher can quite rightly be called an exploration of a student's character and personality. And these wonderful words on the right, Flowery's name may be very true, a psychological experiment in a real life laboratory. How you got on Perisher now is a bit more complicated because we've got a diesel submarine fleet and a nuclear submarine fleet. So an officer would join training class and he'd go to one either submarine to qualify in submarines. And then he'd qualify later on as a navigator or a sonar officer. And he'd become first lieutenant of a diesel submarine or a watch leader in a nuclear submarine. There, from either of those places, he'd get recommended for Perisher. He'd go on Perisher, and then he'd either go in command of one of these submarines or back to or to a nuclear submarine as the executive officer. And when they'd done those jobs, they'd swap over. The executive officer would now go in command of the submarine, and the guy who'd been in command would now go into a nuclear submarine as the exec, before they got recommended for promotion and go in command of a nuclear submarine. Right, I'm going to digress again by looking at a couple of shibboleths of pressure, because of Perisher. And the first one is all about stress and pressure. Okay, pressure is an external force, stress is an internal force. They knew all about pressure and stress in the First World War and the Second World War. And they knew that the easiest manifestation of it, of course, was to hit the bottle. But there were other indicators, very clear indicators. One was an interesting one is that they used to get ridges on their nails at the end of each operational patrol from the psychological stress. Now, pressure and stress is all about a balance between the demands being made on you and your resources to deal with those demands. If you have got, if the resources you have outweigh the demands, then everything's fine. Actually, it's good because you perform better and you get this sense of achievement. But if you feel that the demands are more than you can cope with, you start to express stress effects. Physical, you might start sweating. Mental, you can't think properly. Emotionally, you might get angry. Behavior, you might try to hide somewhere. Now, the idea of Perisher is not to push you to that point. Everybody has a catastrophic stress point where they will just go tumble and go overboard. It's not to push you to that point, it's to push you towards that point so you can recognize when it's coming and know when to pull back. And that's another thing why Woodward put people under this mental stress. And that's where many people fail Perisher. And I'm just going to now show you a lovely chap called David Lister failing Perisher because of these stress effects. And that you'll see what happens.
Back.
30 minutes.
Down. 3,300 yards. Range me on the
center
escort up.
That's the captain of the submarine.
Back. 21 minutes. Now 1,900 yards. 35 seconds. Correction.
That's teacher.
48. 40 seconds.
His mind's not working right properly. And he's not doing his periscope drill properly. Starting to sweat. He's confused.
Lister is still making too many mistakes.
And now he's trying to hide. At that point, he's failed. And what happens is the submarine surfaces, a launch comes alongside. The student who's failed is given a bottle of whiskey, and he will never go to sea in an operational submarine again. Right, the other shibboleth is all about safety and risk. And as one eminent submariner said, being a CO is about knowing about when to take risks and how to take risks. Another one qualifies that. He says it's a risk-benefit analysis job, working within your limitations. You see, what Perisher does is give you the rules and then ask you to break those rules. So David Charlton, the chap you saw on the periscope there, became teacher. He explains it this way. It's like driving on the road. You know what the speed limit is on the road, and you know jolly well you're going to exceed that speed limit. So what do? You just drive a little bit more safely. Another teacher called Chris Munns explains it like this. You're on a cliff face, and your job is to look over that cliff and see what's going on underneath. But you're tied to the cliff by a piece of elastic. If that elastic is too strong, it'll pull you back and you'll never get anywhere. You won't achieve your objective. If, however, you pull against that elastic or it breaks, then you will just tumble over and again, you will fail. So it's knowing where your limitations are, knowing how much to pull against that elastic. Jock McLees also did a review of Perisher in the mid-80s, and he came up with a couple of things. He said, first of all, that teachers now had to have nuclear command experience, not just diesel command experience. He also said that Perisher had to change its name from Commanding Officers Qualifying Course to the Submarine Command Course, because people are not just always going in command of submarines now, they were sometimes going as ex-executive officers of nuclear submarines. That nexus between Perisher and command had been broken. It was left up to three of the best Cold War submariners to do the final transition from a diesel submarine Perisher to a nuclear one. The first was the top there, Tim McClement, and he'd come from sea training. He was at the forefront of war fighting, and he wanted to introduce the best ideas of war fighting into the Perisher. He started to do that. He was joined by Derek Anthony in the middle, and together they revamped the Perisher curriculum. It was left up to Mark Stanhope at the bottom there to finally do the final transfer to an all nuclear Perisher in HMS Conqueror. But of course, a nuclear Perisher was no use to those nations that don't have nuclear submarines. So cut a long story short, this is what happened. The Dutch set up their own Perisher. The Canadians did for a short while, but then reverted to the Dutch. The Australians looked at doing their own Perisher, but reverted to Dutch. I have to say, they've recently set up their own Perisher. And the Norwegians ran their own Perisher anyway. So what they did, they had a memorandum of understanding between these Perisher courses and things so that they could get the benefit from each other's course. Now we come to the end of the Cold War and the start of the post-Cold War period. Well, the state of the submarine service now has changed. At the start of it, we had the 16 diesel boats and 16 SSNs and 4 SSBNs. All the diesel submarines disappear, and indeed, in the interim, 4 new diesel submarines uphold the class come and go, and we're just left with 7 SSNs and the 4 SSBNs. But we do have some exceptional technology. We've now got the Spearfish torpedo, we've got the Tomahawk attack missile, we've got new sonar suites, and the navigation's gone electronic, and so have the periscopes. The one on the left is the old optical attack periscope, the one on the right is now the modern optronics periscopes. Perisher now is a well-organized route. You join submarines and you do a basic warfare course, and then you'll qualify as a submariner, and then you do an intermediate warfare course before you do an advanced warfare course. And this qualifies a submarine officer as what's called a principal warfare officer in submarines, and that matches his qualification with his surface ship counterparts, peers. It's rather like doing a master's degree, really. And from there, he will get recommendation of Perisher, go on Perisher, and then he will always now go as the executive officer of a nuclear submarine. And from there, he goes into a shore appointment, maybe 1, maybe 2, sometimes even 3. So that's where the nexus between the Perisher and command is broken, before he gets selected for commander and then goes in command of a nuclear submarine. Also, selection process went through various permutations until it focused on the modern one, the command competency form, a thorough analysis of a man's capability to go on Perisher. And Perisher dropped down to 1 teacher and maybe 2 or almost 3 Perisher courses a year. There were some good studies, important studies during this period as well. And I'll give you a couple. Captain Harden did one of all the submarine officers. And he came up with lots of conclusions, but I'll give just a couple of them. First one was the XO's qualification. He said, okay, fine. He should be command qualified, but merely, you know, does he have to be? And you might need to look at not having him command qualified. Secondly, he wanted to delay the selection process, pushing it right. So the average age would now be 35. 10 years earlier, the average age had been 30. Remember those rashful young men. And he also laid the groundwork for women in submarines. There's been some recent adverse publicity about that, so I'm not going to comment. But Mrs. Parry is available consultation. although I cannot guarantee that her opinion will be strictly in accordance with present practice. Another very important study was done by a chap called Andy Bauer, as teacher, and he looked at some very important questions and looked at them. But the important conclusion he came to was to do with the submarine command nexus. And he identified that submarine, the course should be divided into two. There should be an SMC1, which was the safety part, and then a second part of the course, which would be a tactical before you go in command. This is what Woodward had said 40 years before. Unfortunately, Bauer didn't know what Woodward had said, because that would by now have been archived. Nobody reads history anyway. And what he recommended got lost largely during a period of churn in the organisations. It certainly wasn't seen by the next teacher, who was a chap called Ryan Ramsey, another radical thinker. He'd done time with the Americans and the Dutch, and he brought in some radical ideas. The first one was that the perisher should meet for the first time in the admiral's cabin of the Victory. Theatrical? Yes. Dramatic? Yes. A bloody good idea, though. And he also renamed the exercises mini wars like the Americans. And he took the perisher to Whitehall, where they met the jurists and politicians. And that was a win-win, because that's the first time these politicians people had met the men who were going to command the nuclear deterrent. And he also looked at best practice from other places like the police and the fire brigade. He also tried to document perisher. Perisher had never been documented, all done on trust. Unfortunately, not all his ideas survived, but by 2017, we see the Americans returning to Perisher, and once now and again a French officer goes through Perisher. There were some untoward happenings. In 1988, the Conqueror Perisher submarine sank a yacht. Nobody was hurt, and it was an army yacht anyway, so nobody bothered. But unfortunately, in 1990, the Trenchant sank the fishing vessel Antares, and four people died in that accident. Perisher now, students are now assessed in three different ways. They're assessed on their safety capability, their tactical capability, and their leadership. And a report in 2019, just 2 years after my study period, identified that during this period, the failure rate had gone up from 25%, where it had been since the end of the Second World War, to 35%. Now, that's either a case of pushing the bar up or the quality of the officers. And having met some of the officers, I don't think it's the latter. Perisher now is full of modules to equip a submarine CO for every eventuality, from war fighting to all the demands of modernity and society change. So I won't go into all of them, except to say that the Perisher now is in four phases. And the first phase is that visual safety phase. And it's now done all ashore in the attack teachers, because such is the fidelity of the attack teachers, they can do it there. But if a man fails, or I should say, if they fail this, they can now go back to sea for more experience. The second phase is a tactical training phase, again done in the attack teachers, because the fidelity of the attack teachers. And again, if they fail this phase, they can go back to sea for more experience. The third phase is a natural shore phase, because it's all about nuclear reactors and the like. And the fourth phase is the tactical at sea phase. Again, the fidelity of the tactics allows them to do this. Now, this is where the student has to show he is fit for command, has to show he can wear the cloak of command, has to show his command prowess, that mix of character and personality and capability and knowledge and bearing and presentation and presence. If he can do that, he'll pass. If he can't, he will fail. Perisher is still subject to a number of questions, and that's good, because it needs to keep itself relevant. Now, I'm going to end not by quoting one of these erudite gentlemen. These are the teachers at the centenary dinner in 2017. I'm going to quote a Russian admiral at the end of the Cold War, when we were still talking to them, said that the best submarine would be an American submarine with Russian weapons and a British commanding officer. Ladies and gentlemen, I have merely scratched the history of the Perisher. It's all in my book, The Perisher, 100 Years of the Submarine Command Course, which the rest of the world you can buy through Amazon. If you're in the UK and contact me on perisher100@gmail.com, I can save you a bob or two. And so now we can go on to questions. And I think I'm going to hand over here to Fiona Sparks. Thank you very much.
If I may, Kevin, first of all, that is absolutely brilliant. I'm exhausted, but I remember the feeling in the old days. spending 2 weeks on the boat, HMS Andrews. It is quite an incredible story. You've just scratched the surface of it, I know. There are so many other aspects. Thank you so much, David. That was brilliant, the most fantastic ending to what is our current series of lectures. And I think we've got a couple of questions to start with, first of all, that he's going to bring in. But I just want to, if I may, just touch on one thing with you, David. And that is actually the interaction between the surface fleet, the general service, and the submarine service. Back in the day when I was serving, which was back in the 70s, submariners make great commanders of frigates, commanding officers of frigates, etc., etc. They had this great ability, and having spent that those few days with Paul Hodiment on Andrew, I can understand exactly why, and how brilliant a man that he was as well. What is the situation now, or indeed, as you're now describing with the example of Conqueror, for example, is a submariner or an aspirant submariner going to spend far less time with the general service in his experience, or is there still that interchange of interaction?
Well, there's two parts to that. Surface ship command is different from submarine command. Surface ship command is more stovepipe. And many submariners, and you talk about Paul Hodnott, who's an exceptionally good case, can do that transition very well. But there were failures because submarine commander, you're far more involved in everything going on a surface ship. You have to rely on your department heads and things. So some submariners do struggle with it. Yeah. As opposed for the interaction with the general service ships, it is missing in the junior officers' training these days. In the old training programs, a junior officer would naturally spend time in all sorts of different service ships. I served in aircraft carriers, frigates, and minesweepers. And so you get to know all the different ships of the Navy. And teachers, when I interviewed teachers, they did comment quite often on the lack of knowledge, general knowledge of the surface Navy that students had. There are very few commands, surface commands, for submarine COs to go to now. And that's having an adverse effect, apparently, because they are not bothering to take the ship command exams because they say, well, what's the bother? I'm not going to get command of a destroyer anyway because the queue's too big. If that answers your
question. It does indeed. It gives a very helpful insight. Thank you. I think probably we've got four questions, I think, showing. Fiona, would you like to come in and actually give us those and see if we can...
Absolutely. Actually, it's one question and three thank yous. So I'll read you the question first, David, which is from Christopher Morgan Jones. And he is asking, why is a submarine captain getting this close to a target when you have sophisticated weapons that can be navigated to a target?
Because the weapons that we're talking about when we're talking about these things, that they were Mark 8 torpedoes. The Mark 8 torpedo was invented in 1927, had a range of about 5,000 yards. So you had to get close to your target. And the closer you get to the target, the more greater your probability of hitting it. I can't remember, just trying to remember what Chris Reefer Brown fired at the Belgrano. It wasn't very far. I think it was about 3,000 yards. Hmm. But the Germans... You see, the Germans used to fire at about 600 metres, I think, something like that. British used to fire out outside about 1,000 yards, something like that. But the Germans wanted to use just one torpedo. You had to get in there. You had to get in and mix it because that's what your weapon allowed you. Today, you don't, of course. You fire from 1 mile away, you know. You've got a sophisticated weapon. It started changing with the Mark 24. We started firing Mark 24s from a long way away. And today, with the Spearfish, they fire from a long, long way. They don't. But the point of having those ships around you doing that is not to train you into shooting them with a torpedo. It's to train you into being able to be safely, to operate safely when you're mixing it with shipping on the surface. You've got to know instinctively what a dangerous ship looks like. And that's what it does. Inculcates that into you, unconsciously, into your consciousness.
That's fascinating.
Thank you. OK, so the rest. J. Julie Ferguson says, happy to see the Canadians mentioned.
Oh, yes. Well, well, I knew her husband.
Simon Parry, what an amazing delivery of information. Thank you. Michael Nottage, absolutely brilliant. Thank you very much. Flavian D'Souza, very comprehensive, David. Right, we have a question from William Maxwell. Yeah. In today's Navy, is it wise to mix male-female crew in such confined spaces?
I mentioned that and I said I am not going to comment on that. But if you want, most willing to put you in touch with my wife and she will give you full flood.
Fine. a question from Dimitri.
Yeah.
What changes in Perisher were implemented after the Falklands War?
Very little, actually. Very little. Post Falklands War, 82, wasn't it? Well, it progressed. The Perisher then was still being done in diesel submarines. And so you went in command of a diesel submarine before you went in command of a nuclear submarine. But towards the end of the 1980s, it did that transfer from diesel submarine Perishers into all nuclear Perishers. So that was the transition. And also the weapons changed in that period. So the way they were doing their attacking changed. To go back to the Welsh gentleman's name, question about what the weapons, the Mark 24s and things came online and then Spearfish. So it's changed in that way. Some things stay the same, like training them in the safety aspects, training them to operate safely when they're amongst ships flying around on the surface. That sort of thing, doing your situational awareness, that's all the same, that stays there. It's just the model, what the platform they're using had changed from diesel submarines to nuclear submarines.
Great.
And good to hear from Dimitri, can I say?
A question from Roger McMorris. Will the Aussies take part in Perishers with the advent of AUKUS?
Well, the Australians are now doing their own Perisher. And the Australians looked at doing Perisher themselves when the Royal Navy went nuclear, but went with the Dutch, and they used to go to the Dutch Perisher. And they would go to the Dutch Perisher for a test of the man's character. And did he have the command prowess, the command presence? So they go to the Dutch Perisher to make sure he had the command presence, he was capable of being in command. And then they used to send them on the American PCO course for more technical training, weapon training, because they fire American weapons. They're now doing their own Perisher there. And I think it probably remains to be seen what they will do when they finally get nuclear submarines down there. I don't honestly know. I have to ask the Australians, I'm afraid.
Right. Alistair, I'm just looking at the time. We're nearly at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
Right. The rest of these are all thank yous, David, which I will send to you.
Too flattering.
Okay, that's great. Now, if you could possibly, David, if it's part of your technical training, could you actually give me the next slide?
Yes.
Thank you very much. There we are. We were going to be having the next lecture on the 16th of January, but we have taken an executive decision that we're actually going to call this the end of what has been a fantastic series of a season of lectures. And we're going to look to probably be doing something in late spring, early summer, in terms of resurrecting another series of lectures. We're going to have a break, in other words. But fear not, because everybody who is actually registered for any of these lectures will be notified exactly what we're doing. And also it will be placed on our website, not that you're checking our website regularly for what's happening in terms of these lectures. So I do thank you all enormously, as well as Dr. David, for today's lecture and for all those lectures you've attended. For those who are coming for the first time, particularly for the very welcome members of the Institute of Seamanship, thank you for coming. Do please register. And once you've registered, or at least you have registered, but having registered, we know who you are. If you're happy for us to keep your email address, we'll be in touch with you with further news on things. We always have to, and if I were Jenny Mosley, who is not here, I'd be saying, if you feel there is the opportunity to donate, if you feel you can do something to help us in terms of the trust, in terms of running and keeping this important resource going for preservation of the headquarters ship Wellington, the old HMS Wellington, the wonderful Second War convoy escort that did 248,000 miles on escort duty. If you can help us, do please click the button and give us something. That's really great. If you'd like now to stay for the wash up, do just stay on, and I'll ask Matt if you can start bringing us across into the informal bit. Remember to take your microphones off if you want to talk. Put yourself on camera, and let's see where it goes from there. I believe, David, you're very kindly going to stay on for a little while for that. We'll make it probably a bit shorter than it was last time, because this lecture has been so engrossing and excellent, but we're running a little over time, but we were expecting to do so. So do stay, and we'll maybe have 10, 15 minutes in the wash-up. Thanks for coming again.
David, do you want to press escape?
Oh, right. Good. Yep. Am I still sharing my screen?
You are.
Do you want me to stop?
Don't worry. No, yes, okay. If you can just stop, that's okay. Lovely.
There we are.
Oh. Right, okay.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Right. Everybody will start coming in now.
Right.
That's great. Angela, that's going to be... lovely to see you again.
Bruce
LeCrème. Bruce, welcome back. Good to have you back again. I hope you're keeping well.
Mute. Yes, thank you. I am keeping very well. It's minus 20 here, and
oh my goodness me,
ready for Christmas.
About minus four.
Yeah. I just want to say one thing. I read Tom Clancy's book a few years ago, his tour of a nuclear submarine. And one of the things he pointed out at the end of it, and you know, take Tom Clancy, if you like him or not, one of the things he said was that the people, navies feared RN submarines because of the perisher course. I thought that was an interesting comment.
Interesting.
Indeed. Yeah, he was a great fan of perisher.
Yeah. He was some. It's very interesting. There was I was just aware of the fact there was a great divide. There were submariners and there was surface navy, and not so much now the twain would meet, but there was a great respect for the submariners, and they were so much independent. And I think those early comments that David you made in your earlier slides about the integrity and the qualities of the submarine commander were so relevant. This independence. Almost this kind of sort of coastal forces rig, rusty cap, cover, U-boat type approach towards command. It's probably a bit of a myth.
No, it's absolutely true. They, in fact, they didn't wear uniforms at all. Old flannels and rugby shirts were the order of the day. And in the Far East, they just used to wear a sarong. Well, I used to wear a sarong in the Far East. And of course they had the woolly pulley. You never see any photographs of them. You see lots of photographs of submariners in woolly pulleys, you know, royal neck sweaters, but you never see them in what we call pirate rig, because that was frowned upon.
Indeed. That's great, Bruce, thanks for that. That's great. Thomas, good to see you back. Indeed, how are you keeping? You've got that wonderful model of yours that you built behind you.
Keeping very well, getting ready for Christmas. I must say, this was a tremendous presentation.
They are still in the game. They're still playing.
It was amazing.
I think it's a nice couple of times. All the time, it's only one.
There we are. It was as exhausting as a stack in a submarine, I felt, following that. It was terrific. There it is. Travis. Travis Petzold, I hope I got your name right.
You did indeed.
Oh, great. Welcome. Good. I don't think you've been on before, but you're very welcome.
Oh, thank you. No, I haven't been here, but I was interested in the subject matter, and I have the book, but I haven't read it yet. So thank you for that great presentation. I'm an American who's also a perisher graduate. So I found it fascinating, and you know, I the course holds special meaning for me. So it was just fantastic.
You did perisher, did you?
I did, and did in 2008 under Philip Titterton.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, well done.
Well, thank you. It was one of the highlights of my submarining career, and I've commanded an American submarine and all that, and yeah. I will always remember it extremely fondly. And to the Tom Clancy point, it was probably his book that said, oh, I want to do that someday if I have an opportunity to do so.
Right. Yeah. Good for you. Yeah. Then you went on the PCO course.
Yes. Yes. And so fun. I got to do that twice because we do it as both an XO and a CO. And they're both great courses. They're different. They kind of reflect our different styles. As I always told Americans, I'm like, going to Perisher made me a better submarine CO than I would have been without it. You know, and so they're both very valuable, and they are slightly different, but it was great to do both.
That's interesting. Interesting insight. Thanks, Travis, for answering that. David, I've got to introduce you to Holly Rosenberg. She comes every lecture. She has a hand up at the moment. Holly, how are you keeping? You're up. Can you describe to Dr. David where you are exactly?
David, first of all, I want to thank you. You are a dynamic speaker. That was a dynamic presentation. I live in Kenosha, Wisconsin. That is in southeast Wisconsin. Right. And it is at Lake Michigan. And my apartment windows face Lake Michigan. It is raining for the last 3 days. The waves are high. They say we're going to have snow tomorrow. Who knows? I would like to wish Alistair, Fiona, Jenny, David, all of our participants, a happy Merry Christmas and a healthy and happy New Year.
And to you. As well, Holly. Thank you so much for that. That's great. That really is. And where are we? We've got a few cameras not on, but there it is. David, how's Cape Town? David Blake.
What's the weather?
I'm not sure if David is there.
Isn't he? He's there. I can see him. Well, at least I can see his name.
Yeah. I'm not sure if Matt's just let him in and he hasn't participated.
No, that's right. Anyway, for all those of you who are here, this is absolutely, it's great to have you here. And thank you so much. This book, I think, deserves to be read. I think it's a rare opportunity, actually. Yeah, if you'd like to get it out, David, can you give us a flash of the cover or something of that sort of your book? Have you got a copy by, are you?
I'm sorry. My wife was put her head round. Sorry, the copy of the book? The book is here.
Copy of the book? There
yes.
It is.
Yeah. Can you see it?
That's good.
I can't see myself. I was just wondering, how do I see people on the screen here?
No, that's fine.
We see your book.
Okay, that's good. Right. Okay.
We can see your book's the most important thing in America.
Oh, we can see you, David.
Can I just say hello to Charles Hattersley? I see he's on the call there.
Charles, you're on there. Are you on mute? You're on mute.
I just unmuted. Hello, David. Yeah, nice to see you again.
Charles, how nice to talk to you after all these years.
Yeah. Now, I was just going to say, we're all buddies in boats, but sometimes buddies disappear.
Yeah. Sadly, too many.
And a Canadian friend of mine, Ken McWilliness, he's on there.
Yep. Yeah, no, very good talk, David. Well done putting it all together. Very brilliant. I like all the background stuff. Excellent. Well done.
All right, Charlie. Got to buy the book, Charles.
Yeah, maybe. I've got to get onto Amazon first. Right.
drop me a note. I'll sell it to you.
No, you've done a lot of work. You've done a lot of research. It's pretty interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
Paul Kenley, there you are in Auckland. Great for you to come on. I don't know what time of the day or night it is for you, but anyway, you're very welcome. You're on mute at the moment. Do you want to say a word, Paul? Were you there for the lecture? I think I've lost again.
I'm not sure that Matt has let them in, but it doesn't mean that they're actually there.
No.
There's my daughter on. I can see my daughter on the call as well. And Nigel, Nigel the uncle.
Sorry,
they're in New Zealand as well.
It's Matt here. They are all here. It's just they've decided to keep their cameras off.
Okay.
They're keeping them off. Very good. I'm just seeing who else we have up here.
David Blake has unmuted himself.
Oh, David, do you want to put yourself on camera?
We can't see you, David.
Where are you? What's the weather?
It's probably raining down there as well, Holly. Yeah. Yeah, I think you're having a problem getting a picture up. It's probably bandwidth issue. If you can hear, so you're right, David.
They say they can't see you.
Who, me? You're talking about me?
No, we didn't see.
No, it's not this David. Somebody
well,
else.
No, it's another David. David
Lantaine. Is that who it's speaking of? Oh, this is fun. Oh. It's like a submarine.
I just saw somebody.
Yeah, that was my daughter.
That was you. That was your daughter. Did she come up on screen as well?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Wow.
You're like, oh god.
Technical challenges today.
There's Nigel. Okay. Hello.
Very good.
Hi. Oh, there's David.
David Blake, you're on. Welcome. How are you?
Well, good evening to you. I can't see myself, so this is most unnerving. But it was a very interesting talk and left me absolutely breathless. All I can say about in South Africa, we're going through a most amazing thing where a Russian vessel comes into Simonstown without its RFID on and that sort of thing. And we just, there seems to be a lot of sort of shadow boxing or something going on, and we'd love to know what is going on.
Interesting.
That's right. Thank you so much for the talk. That was really very interesting.
Yes, we read about the Russian ship.
Incredible. There we are. I think probably we're getting towards 8:15. So, and we're all exhausted, having been through, I don't know how many attacks you've done for us, David. Probably it feels like 3, at least. Can I just thank you again for an incredibly good summary of the whole darn thing. And what a long story, what a complex story it is. The only I learned things from it the whole time. What I learned is when I did do this, was standing by as 18th hand on that attack that was done on HMS Andrew with Paul Hodinot. I think I was on the with the Chinagraph Plensel on the plot for the right
unburied plot.
That's right. Yeah. Now it all comes back to me with horrible reality. Just one last thing I want to ask you about dazzle paint. I've always thought that dazzle paint on ships was to actually break up the profile for someone looking through. But I think actually the way you described it, I think I'm rethinking that.
It was to put
people off the getting the angle, the bow off angle. Was that right?
Yeah, well, that was part of it. Yeah. It can just anything to confuse the submarine CEO when he's trying to take a shot at you. Yeah,
absolutely. So, incredible story. Well, there we go. Look, I won't sing, even though I'm singing a concert this week in Suffolk. I won't sing, but I will say how much I wish you all a very happy and blessed Christmas and a good new year, the new year I think we all need in this troubled world. And I thank you again all for coming, especially to hang over at the NDA for the watch-up. And from your various lives and your various places, I wish you well. And we will notify you when we're back on air again for the next series of lectures. And once again, finally, David, thank you so much for you coming, giving of your time so well. Thomas, good to see you. Guys, our friends across the pond. And Bruce, good to see you all. And Holly, how can we forget you?
Good to see all of you. Good to see you all. Stay well, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Merry Christmas.
Thanks, David.
Merry Christmas to everybody.
Merry Christmas. Happy and healthy.
Merry Christmas.
Great.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.